going to take up our tithes and offerings. Again, we thank you for supporting us here, as it does cost money to keep the lights on and everything. So, but we know most importantly that when you invest in God's economy, that you'll reap.
Amen.
And so, so let's just pray. Father, we thank you and we praise you now. And Father, we ask that you would lead us by your Holy Spirit in what to give, Lord God. And we thank you now for blessing those, Father. Those that give, I ask you to bless them in the mighty name of Jesus, Father God. Bless them spirit, soul, and body. Meet the need here. Father, give us this day our daily bread. And we thank you and we praise you now in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen.
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 Hallelujah. Angels bow before him.
Thank you.
Can you just see that in your spiritual eye? What a mighty God we serve. Angels bow before him.
Amen.
Heaven and earth adore him. My God, my God. The miracle working God, that all time, right on time, God.
Amen.
Right now, God. The God that hung the stars in the sky, that told the rivers when to stop, the mountains how high to go. What a mighty God we serve. My God, my God. Mary, did you know my husband and I are on the same page? He was going to play the song, and I want to play the song, so I guess we need to play the song. Mary, did you know? My God, my God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
What a mighty God we serve. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Mary, did you know? Your faithful.
Did you know that your baby would one day walk on water? Mary, did you know that your baby boy will save our sons and daughters? Did you know?
You kissed the face.
He said, great I am that I am.
Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Before Abraham was, he says, I am. My God, I am that I am. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. You may be seated.
Thank you, Jesus.
Nice to see some people dancing.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
We used to do a lot of that. I can remember Dad taking off and going across the platform.
That's right.
Dancing from one side to the other, people dancing.
Thank you, Jesus.
Worshiping
the Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah.
You had to get to the point, you had to tell people to calm down a little bit so you can get on and preach, you know.
Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Father, we thank you this day.
Yes, Lord.
For the gifts and the callings of God. Father, I ask you to help me now. For I'm not worthy to preach your word, Lord God, except for that my righteousness is in you, Lord. So, Father, I ask that the Holy Spirit would come, and that anointing would come, Father, to bring forth your word, and that you would prepare the hearts of the people here in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
We're in this Christmas season, and you know, sometimes it kind of irritates me what you say. Now, I was kind of surprised. I heard some people at work saying the same thing, but sometimes it just gets so commercialized, and one of my patients said, yeah, about July 4th if they start. You know?
Yeah.
And Thanksgiving, and really, Thanksgiving just kind of brushed over. That was a big thing, too. I didn't realize so much, but I mean, there was religious freedom. They thank God that they were able to survive those winters and so forth. And that's all kind of brushed over now, you know. And they've already started Christmas. Kind of get irritated with all the, well, I'll be mad at them. But don't get, if you get mad at me, the Bible says you got to love me. But I'd be upset with all the Halloween stuff that's in place, too, good Lord. But anyway, we're in this Christmas time. And you know, I didn't realize that you watch stuff, but Mother pointed this out probably a few years back, that they call the Christmas story now, they're going to sit down and read the Christmas story, and then they start, well, night before Christmas and all through the house. That's not the Christmas story. That's one of the reasons we continue to have church on Christmas Eve and so forth, that we can proclaim the true Christmas story.
That's right.
That a baby was born, or we're celebrating that birth that actually was before that, like scholars feel was in the fall. But we celebrated on December the 25th. But a baby was born to die.
Right.
He was born to be that perfect sacrifice that we might have life. That we might have an abundant life, thank God. That we might have eternal life. You know, this isn't it. You know, as Abraham said, we're just pilgrims, we're sojourners. So we really don't fit in here. I don't know about you, but a lot of times I just don't feel like I fit in. And the world goes off and doing all the things that they do, you know. And we're just kind of odd and look that weird and, you know.
That's okay.
But one day, he will rule. One day, the Lord will return.
Amen.
You know, I've been listening on Wednesday nights, Brother Swigert's preaching on end time events. And he's on their broadcast, it comes on at 8 o'clock our time, isn't it? And he preaches for a little while, then he's been going over end time events and saying how close we are, you know, to the return of the Lord. He's going over some of the things that's happening. And it's been kind of an encouragement and excitement, you know. And I guess you don't hear too much of it preached anymore. We don't hear too much of the cross preached anymore. We don't hear too much about sin preached anymore. I got in trouble some time back because, you know, these new preachers now, and this was some people in Columbus, and I never met this guy. I talked a little bit on Facebook, and he goes out and does street ministry. That's great. Well, then he brought up about repentance, you know. Well, now the new thing, Jay, is when you preach repentance, you don't tell them what to repent from. Oh, that will offend them. And this guy got in a fight with me on them. And then what was amazing is there was four or five pastors that chimed in with him. And oh no, you don't. You offend them. You need to just tell them to turn to the Lord, but you don't tell them to turn from. Well, that's not what Jesus preached. And that's not what John the Baptist preached, and so forth. John the Baptist got beheaded because he talked about what was a King Herod and the things that were going on. He said you need to turn from those things. You know. And we do need to turn from those things to something. Our faith needs to be in Christ. Amen. Romans chapter 5. We're going to review a little bit. Romans chapter 5 and verse 20. It says, moreover, the law entered that the offense might abound. But where sin abound, grace did much more abound. The law came in to do one thing, and it was to show you that you're a sinner. It was to point out sin, to define sin. And it was to show you, the law said, you got to live by this. And so the law said to Jay, it said, Jay, you got to follow these rules. And guess what Jay couldn't do? He couldn't follow the rules. I don't care how hard he tried. And what the religious folk of that time did then, is that what the Jews ended up doing, is there was a few rules, and they kept adding rules and adding rules and adding rules to try to be more righteous. And they couldn't even keep the rules that they already had. We can't keep the rules that we already have. We can't keep the law. There's no salvation in the law. If there had been, then Jesus wouldn't have had to come. But there's no salvation in law because we can't. Because Paul says that the flesh is weak, have no confidence in the flesh. The flesh can't do this. So when the flesh is told not to do something, now you've all had. Tell a teenage boy that he can't do something. Yeah. I remember that. Good thing he's not listening in right now. I won't say which teenage boy, but I told one of the teenage boys, do not be on the phone at this time. Well, man, that phone was an object, man. He had to be on that phone because I said not to be. You take a baby, you know, babies aren't innocent. Babies are born with a sin nature. Just take 2 2-year-olds and put them in a crib or in a playpen with one toy, and you'll see the sin nature. You don't have to train them to be good or to be bad. You got to train them to be good. They already have that nature within them to be bad. So when the law came, then it caused that sin nature within man to rise up. But praise God, when the sin rised up, there was much more grace, the grace of God, to cover that sin. And this is what Paul is saying there. That as sin has reigned unto death, even so might grace reign through the righteousness of Christ unto eternal life by Jesus Christ our Lord. And so grace can reign if we will put our faith where it needs to be. And it's in nothing that we do. And I battle with that even yet. Your righteousness isn't in your attending church. Oh, I know that doesn't go. I have pastors like Tom who got mad at me. Well, if you tell my people that, they aren't going to come to church and they need to get saved then.
Ah, right.
I seen you over at the steakhouse, sizzling. Why were you there? Yeah, you were hungry. I didn't have to say, Jay, you need to eat. Did anybody have to tell you that? No, you go get it. Why? Because you're hungry.
Yeah.
Now we should have a spiritual hunger that I shouldn't have to tell you. We should want to get together. We should want to attend church. The Bible says not to forsake the assembly of ourselves. The Bible says that we should read the word and we should pray and we should fast and all these things. But it's not what makes us righteous. And another thing that I'm beginning to realize, you're just as righteous as you'll ever be. There's not a partial justification. I was listening to Brother Lauren preach something the other day. And he said, you know what? I'm just as justified when I'm out there with my car rage yelling at the person as I was a few minutes before. And I thought about that. Because he says the righteousness of God, the forgiveness of the sin, is for past, present, and future. Not that you don't ask God to forgive you. And the reason he was preaching on that is because of a teaching that had went around that you're saved, unsaved, you're righteous, unrighteous, saved, righteous, unrighteous, and you keep coming up and getting re-saved. Yeah. Yeah. You're as saved as you ever be, you're just as righteous as you ever be if your faith is in Christ, even though you mess up.
That's right.
Now the Holy Spirit will be there to bring that conviction Because there's also, I hear all, I'm not out in these little churches, so I don't know, but I enjoy listening to Sun Life when I can, and they'll talk about these other, what's going on. Well, now there's a new teaching out, I guess, is you don't ask God for forgiveness anymore. You're just automatically forgiven. You know, error rides into the back of truth.
Yeah.
There's some truth there. But yet we know that the working of the Holy Spirit is to convict you of sin. And then we know in 1 John 1:9 it says, when you sin, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sin and cleanse us. So evidently we go and we ask for forgiveness.
Yes.
Between the brazen, as I've said before, the brazen altar and the brazen laver, they got defiled. Mm-hmm. Brazen altar was symbolic of salvation. Brazen laver was symbolic of the Word of God. And a reflection showing them, and they got defiled walking from the brazen altar to the brazen laver. As we get defiled because we're in this world, we're still in this flesh. Mm-hmm. And Paul says, don't have any faith in this flesh. Hello? No faith in the flesh. You can only have your faith in Him. What shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid! Away with the thought! Now I've had people even say to me, well, Pastor Mark, you're giving people a license to sin. No, I'm not. Jay, the law says you can't. Don't say anything about hating me, does it?
No.
It doesn't. The law doesn't say anything about hating. So if you have ill feelings toward me, you're not breaking the law. But Jesus went on to say, the spirit of the law is you can't even hate. Greater accountability to being under under grace or under the leading of the Holy Spirit than it is to being under law. Because the Holy Paul at the law says you can't commit adultery. Jesus went on to say, yeah, but the spirit of the law says you can't think it in your mind. Greater accountability. So I'm not giving you a license to sin. I'm saying you need to be, the sons of God are led by the Spirit of God, and you need to be led by the Spirit of God. And as the Spirit of God brings conviction to you, you turn those things over to God and ask Him to cleanse you of those things. Mm-hmm. And you can't do it yourself, though. Because you see how they tried. And you can try to work out the plan of God for your life. But let's talk about Abraham. You know all that problem we got over there today? Yeah. They're fighting over there. Trump just said, you know, Jerusalem be the headquarters and all these Palestinians are. Thank your father Abraham. Because thank Sarah too. Because Sarah said, Abraham, go in unto Hagar and let's make this baby so we can get this promise going. Yeah. A working of the flesh, and look what it did. Yeah. We still have it today. It went on to say that Ishmael, would they be a warlike people and they wouldn't get along with anybody. And they don't. Do they? Now we do that. That was written for us for admonition. Because sometimes we try to have our Ishmael.
No, that's true.
Sometimes we try to work out the plan of God ourselves. You know, something interesting about prophecy. And Dad operated in a much greater realm than I do. But he used to prophesy to people what they thought that was going to happen to Paul. And I came around, I was just in a conversation not too long ago with somebody. All these conversations, I talked to patients and I don't remember who told me this, but somebody just said, yeah, there was a prophecy given to me. And you know, it took 20 years before it came to pass. Because sometimes, like, you know, there's no time really with God. And God had told Abraham that it would come from his own flesh, from his loins, you know. And yet, he got impatient. There's sometimes we get impatient with God, and we just need to allow Him to... I'm preaching to myself today, you're just listening in. I'm preaching to myself, because I get impatient. We get that McDonald's mentality, you know. And sometimes McDonald's isn't even very fast anymore. How should we who are dead to sin live any longer in? What Paul was saying is, you have died to sin when you've put your faith in Christ, when you've been born again, when you've made Him Lord and Savior. Oh, wait a minute now. Romans 10, 9, 10 says, Lord and Savior. Uh-oh. Lord. Mm-hmm. Slave. Mm-hmm. Master. Mm-hmm. Uh-oh. Mm-hmm. I like to say that is because being a PK, everybody knows what a preacher's kid, I've seen a lot of things, you know. And this freedom stuff came out, that you're free. Well, you are free. You're free from sin. Mm-hmm. But you're slave unto God. Mm-hmm. Slave of righteousness, it says. And so, Christians aren't doing anything they wanted to do. Mm-hmm. Not realizing that they're not free to do their own thing because they have a master. Your Father in heaven is your master. Now it says, oh, it's great to be under your Father in heaven because He only cares for that which is good for you. He's only going to do that which is good for you. He's going to allow that which is good for you, which your earthly masters at times weren't like that. But your heavenly masters like that, you know. But we have to be led by the Spirit of God as to what does God want us to do. So we had a lot of people doing weird things. Never will forget. I shouldn't bring it up. I will. Dad was preaching, and these people were walking around the building. It wasn't here. It was at Bob Turner's house. And they were walking around the building, the whole message. So me being a nosy kid that I am, you're a nosy kid. I heard him call him aside when after the, and he said, come here. I don't remember the name. And I'm kind of listening to him. He says, what were you doing? Well, God told us to walk around the building while you're preaching. Dad said, that wasn't God. Because Scripture says that there's been a gift given. You know the gift, the fivefold. The gift is in here preaching behind the pulpit. You need to sit under the gift, not be out. Well, we're free to do whatever you want to do. Yeah, Dad said, you're not free to do that in my service. There will be order. They never came back again. But they were free. No, they were out of the will of God. And they were not correct. They couldn't be corrected. They were unteachable. Never get to the place you get so big that you get unteachable. Especially when we've been saved 30 years and we know it all. No, yeah. Until I heard the old gray-haired preacher one day. I forget who it was. Somebody on the radio. It's been a few years back. Now, it could have even been down at the assembly. It could have been that long ago. Somewhere I heard a preacher. Gray, old gray-haired guy. And he said, I don't know anything. So I used to think I knew it all. He said, the more I preach it, the more I realize I don't know anything. I thought, man, that's terrible. You should know more. But I see it because the Word of God is so inexhaustible. I heard Brother Swigert some time back. Now, how long has he been preaching? He's 82 now. He started when he was like 16 or 18, I guess. At the time that he said this, he wasn't 82 yet. But he said he walked across the street to the Bible college and went in and sat to listen to a first-year Bible college student. And he said, you know what? That first-year Bible college student taught me something that I didn't know. Mm-hmm. Now I'll tell you something about Brother Swigert. Mm-hmm. His pastime is reading the Bible. His pleasure is reading the Bible. Obviously. He reads the Bible. Mm-hmm. How do you know that? Because I spoke to Donnie Swigert in my car. Mm-hmm. Was talking personally to Donnie. Donnie's like, yeah, can't hardly get Daddy to do anything. He just wants to be in the Bible and be praying all, that's just his thing. He just, we'll go on vacation somewhere. Daddy's back in the hotel room studying. I mean, I've never sat down and read whole commentaries. That man does. Mm-hmm. I talked to Lauren. Lauren says, if you ever go into Brother Swigert's office, here's what you're going to see. You're going to walk in, and he said, from one end of the desk to the other will be commentaries open, and he's been studying. And Bibles and things, you know. And yet a first-year Bible college. Why am I saying that? First-year Bible college says, because the Word of God is inexhaustible. And Brother Swigert understands that. And he knows that he'll get up and say, man, we've just scratched the surface. Because the Bible talks about that throughout all eternity that God's going to reveal Himself to us, unto us throughout all eternity. And you see that revelation upon revelation upon revelation. He started out in the Garden of Eden. He gave him a little bit of revelation. Then he goes on to the prophets and he gave more revelation. Then it comes on and then John the Baptist comes in more revelation. And continual revelation upon revelation. He continues. Because the Bible says that God delights on the desire of his heart is to reveal himself to you. And now we have great revelation. We just have to read it. Be careful with those that bring revelation that's not in the book. It better be in the book. And I've heard all kinds of stuff. And I've seen all kinds of stuff. And I've seen people try to manipulate the Holy Spirit, do all these things. And I said, God, I don't want to do that. I want to truly be led and preach what you have me to preach. And there's times, yeah, you get up and you just sit back down and you're like, well, I shouldn't have said that. Or I didn't say that quite right. One thing used to bother me with my dad, and I do it myself, and he cut sentences off. Because these thoughts start coming. And I do it now. I just did it a minute ago. And you go halfway through a sentence, and I need a thought, and all of a sudden their thought comes, and I go on to the next one. And there's times I'm there waiting, Dad, you just cut that sentence off. What was that? And I catch myself, you know. So you don't do everything perfect. So I ask the Holy Spirit then to help me.
Yeah.
And where I cut a sentence off, or I didn't say something quite right, I say, Holy Spirit, I've asked you, please, show the people greater revelation than what this flesh can bring forth. Amen.
Amen.
How shall we who are dead to sin live any longer therein? Know you not that so many of us that were baptized into Christ, or Jesus, were baptized into his death. Mm-hmm. It's not talking about water baptism. It's talking about immersed into Christ. We're baptized into his death. You die. Mm-hmm. The only way you can get free from the sin nature is to die because Satan had a legal right to you. In the court of law, he was given a legal right. You were declared in the courtroom of heaven guilty. It says condemnation came upon all flesh. Declared guilty by God, not by me. I'm not preaching into hell. I'm not saying that's where you're going. But I tell you that's where you're going if you haven't done the right thing. And I'm not the one that sent you there. Actually, I don't want you to go.
That's right.
There's people I don't like. I know all of you aren't like that. But I am. There's people I don't like. I mean, I think upon people. And sometimes in my mind, I think of somebody. And I'm like, I don't really like that person. I had a boss one time that I just didn't like her. She was just mean and nasty, you know. And I wouldn't mind if she had maybe a lightning bolt just kind of burn her a little or something. Maim her a little, you know. But you know what? Mm-hmm. I never wanted her to go to hell.
No.
Because hell is eternal.
Amen. Yeah. Right.
Hell is forever. So is heaven, you know. But hell is eternal. That's why I preach what I preach, because I don't want you to go there. And if I see you on that road, you know, it don't take a whole lot of sense to know that if you get on that road out there, which is called Elida Road, and you go that way, you're going to end up in Elida and then Lima. You're going to end up there. If you're on that road, that's where you're going to go. Now you can say, Mark, you're judging me. Well, I am, I guess. But if you go east on Elida Road, you're going to go to Lima.
Yeah.
Come to Elida first, then Lima. Keep on going. I mean, you end up in, where does it end up? In Ada or something. It keeps on, you'll end up, well, eventually you'll end up on the East Coast, I guess. If you're on that wide road to destruction, you're going to end up in hell.
Mm-hmm.
And that's not where I want you to be.
That's right.
Because we just talked about Mary, did you know?
That's right.
That baby was born because you are worth it.
Yeah, that's right.
God loves you.
Yes.
God loves you so much. The Bible says, for God so agape'd the world. He sent his own. Agape is love. He loved the world. But I like to use agape because it's different than what we run into. If I'm nice to Linda, she'll be nice to me. But if I'm kind of nasty to Linda, she'll be nasty back. Not agape love. Worldly. Was it phileo? I see it all the time with people you have to associate with. It was funny, we were just talking at work, and one of my patients talked about friends. And the one guy was saying something about, well, I don't have very many friends, blah, 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 you know. And he said, you'll find that most friends won't stick with you. And I said, yeah, I have heard, maybe seen it on Facebook, that a true friend is somebody who is still with you after you've went through the storm.
Mm-hmm.
And my patient said, yeah, let me tell you what that is. That's called a fair weather friend. I said, yeah, I understand that. The worldly kind of love. But even while you were still an enemy of God, he still loved you. Right? And he loved you so much that God became flesh, the incarnation. Because that's the only way that the sin debt could be repaid. Is it had to be a perfect sacrifice.
Right.
And no man can be a perfect sacrifice because we are born, the Bible says we took upon ourselves the Adamic nature, the satanic nature, the
right.
nature of Satan, the nature of Adam and Abel gave us. And so we can't be a perfect sacrifice. So Jesus had to come as that perfect sacrifice to set us free from that sin nature. And so you're dead in Christ. We're identified with Christ in his death, his burial, and his resurrection. And so we died. And so it says that, don't you know that those were, that we were baptized into his death, so we should not want to serve sin? Now I'm not saying you'll never fall short, though. I'm not saying that. We see instances in Scripture where they fell short. You know what they say about David? I can't understand it. They say that David was a man after God's own heart. David had an affair with the naked lady on the roof next to him. He got her pregnant, had her husband sent for, and had him sent back and had him killed, trying to cover up his sin. And yet God's word says he had a heart after God. Why? Because he repented of that. And he talks about blessed is the man whose sins are for how is covered or forgiven. And that's the same with us. We've all messed up. The Bible says if you say you're without sin, you're a liar. Then you're standing right there. I thought it interesting that Paul was writing to Christians and telling them not to lie. Christians! No, I'm not talking about the drunk out on the street. Paul was talking to Christians and telling them to stop lying. That means Christians must have a problem with lying.
Yeah.
Amongst other things. When you come into this house of God, you're coming into a hospital. I work in a hospital. I don't ever see well people. I treated a patient on Friday. She was not well. She was recovering, and we were helping her get well after a total knee surgery. But she wasn't well. Now, I didn't go speak bad of her because she had come there to get healed. And so there's going to be those that are going to come into this hospital to be healed. And guess what? I can't heal you. No, I can't heal you. I don't have it. But what can I do? I can direct you to the healer.
Right.
I can say, put your faith in what Christ has done. Look to him.
Amen.
The healer. I'm studying Jehovah. The names of Jehovah. One of them's healer. Look at. I can take it. And we used to have men that thought that they could get up and they could do all these things. See, being a PK gave you some advantages. I not only seen you behind the pulpit, Jay, but I knew what you were doing in your house. Several preachers. You know them personally. And you knew that what was coming across the pulpit was different than what was in the house sometimes. Oh, we all do that. I know that none of you ever get mad, but I do. Say, I never will, but I do. I back the Lord and say, Lord, help me. And I see a progression. I see God doing a work in me, but we all have our shortcomings.
Amen.
Jeanette talked about getting frazzled. Today was kind of one of those days, you know. I got out here to church early, kind of on purpose, just to get him. The dog made a mess, and we tried to give him other food, and it didn't agree with him, and oh my. So Jeanette was cleaning that up, and then I lost my watch. I had a secretary downstairs, couldn't find it. Couldn't find a pair of glasses to save me. Couldn't find my pants. Lost my wallet. All in the same morning, you know, trying to get ready for church. Couldn't find my socks. The pair of socks that I found were those little short little things, and I thought, well, I don't want to wear them. And you find yourself getting frustrated. Jeanette said something, and I kind of snapped at her a little bit, and I caught myself. I thought, it's trying. Don't have confidence in this flesh. It'll let you down. I'm going to do this. No, you're not. You can't. Paul couldn't. Paul talked about confidence in the flesh. Paul said he knew the law better than anybody. He was a keeper of the law better than anybody. He sat under the greatest teachers, and yet he says, have no confidence in the flesh. I count that all as dung for the righteousness of Christ. That's the only place your righteousness is going to be. But isn't it neat? You don't have to perform for God to love you. But when you understand that, James talks about it. And James says, well, if you have this righteousness in you and you understand that you have this righteousness in you, that which comes forth then will be fruits of that righteousness. The fruits didn't make you righteous. The fruits are there because you are righteous because of Him, of His righteousness. God's standard of righteousness.
Amen.
Man's standard of righteousness. And it's interesting,
hallelujah.
Man's standard of righteousness. Yeah. I would fit, well, I wouldn't. I have to take that off. I wouldn't fit in very well in some standards of righteousness. You'd have to take off that mascara. You'd have to take off, you got pants on. So you're already on your way to hell.
Wow.
Well, yeah, but they support.
Ridiculous.
Man's standard of righteousness. But what's God's standard? Well, the book tells you.
Yeah.
And there is a standard of righteousness, and we can't live up to it. But the Holy Spirit enables us to do that.
Yes, that's
right.
Yes,
hello? And then there's nothing wrong with, we live in this world, and some of us need a little makeup. Well, the ladies at work was teasing, you know, and she got running late one day. And she was Mary Kay or something, I think. If we told her, you better see your Mary Kay lady again. But she came in, and it must have been a day I wasn't there, but she had patients and coworkers coming out, so she was sick. She says, well, I'm not sick. Well, what happened? My alarm clock didn't go off, and I didn't have any time to put any makeup on. And she says, and she was kind of joking about it. She was telling the story. She says, yeah, people thought that I was sick because I just looked bad, you know. I just, you know. But she says, I put a little makeup on, and I look good, you know. Nothing wrong with that, you know. But see how we like to control people. I like to hit on that too, because I seen that. I seen that from behind the pulpit. Used to irritate my dad too, who would talk about it, because there were different preachers that he knew who tried to control people. To the point that if you want to go on vacation this week, you got to have your pastor as your covering. I can't be your covering, by the way.
No.
I don't have the ability to be anybody's covering. Only God can be your covering. But you had to go to the pastor to ask permission. And I'm one of these people I kind of knew. You know, I knew this was the truth, you know. Control. Jesus showed us how a pastor should be. And it's hard, man. I started studying that and I said, man. Because I like the idea. I remember this one pastor one time. We went to this service. And this guy had an entourage around him. And they put his coat on for him. They poured his water for him. He went to sit down at the table, and they pulled his seat out. They pushed him up. They put his, and they stood there, and he immediately, you know. But Jesus washed their feet.
That's right.
Thank you.
That's right.
Jesus said he was there to serve.
Yeah.
We're here to serve.
Yeah.
It's a very important job to be a preacher of the gospel.
Yeah.
You know, I didn't understand it at first. I heard Brother Swigert say, he said, being a preacher of the gospel is a higher calling than being the president of the United States.
Yeah.
And at first I thought, well, you know, and some preachers have money, and the majority of us don't.
Mm-hmm.
It's not a very good paying job, has good eternal benefits.
Yeah.
You know. And that's the sad thing, what they're trying to do now, they look at a few ministries that are huge, and then they want to take all the benefits away. And there's hundreds of us out here. You know, I just got done talking to a Gideon just the other day. Man, to a guy, I didn't know he was a Gideon. He told me he was a Gideon. I've known him for a long time. He said, well, how many people do you have? He said, you know, people like to ask you that. They don't ask, are you preaching your word or people doing it? They want to know, how many people's in your church? You know, And then you see it in their eyes. You say, oh, you're not about 20. Or, oh, you're one of, oh, you're not a real pastor, you know. So anyway, he asked me, and I kind of, well, you know, I said, well, on a real good Sunday, 25. He said, how about a bad Sunday, 10? He said, you know what, Mark? He says, that's what I'm seeing in the churches that are really preaching. They're small like that. Then I heard him talk about it. I heard him question him on the broadcast because, you know, Lauren and different ones, they go around to different churches. You know, they hear, people call in and talk to them, you know, they hear. And they said the average size church is only like about 50 or less. It's a lot of them less. Because the church is asleep, and they've fallen for all this stuff.
Yeah.
I went to one of them, you know. And you have the screens, and I'm not with having screens, I guess. Like, you probably wouldn't want to see my ugly face up on a big screen. It's bad enough I see this, you know, make anybody sick, you know. But then they have the mist. I'm like, shit, there's mist coming down. I wonder what that's for, you know. Well, I looked into, I guess that's part of the atmosphere you're supposed to have. Bring people into the presence of God. You have a mist. Wouldn't have got to be the true mist of God. But you know what that counts by, though. You got to do some praying and stuff. Here you go.
Yeah. Yes, Lord.
Then they make it like a nightclub. And you can bring your drinks in. And don't make it last too long because people are too busy. And like, don't say anything about sin and don't make people feel bad. Sometimes there's that place of correction.
Yeah, right.
They talk about the spiritual woodshed. Mm-hmm. I have Lauren Larson taking the spiritual woodshed in this building, in my office. You know? And he did it because I had told him, I want to do this right. And he's seen things that could have been better, you know, while we were. I've gotten to a place I wouldn't take up an offering because people got on my case about offerings. And that's not scriptural. And we don't want to give. And people that did it didn't want to give any money. Matter of fact, I came to find out that the one guy that came against me so hard, he wanted the church to pay his utility bills. And I said, no, you know. So go work. By the way, you should be tithed. Oh, I'm not going to, you know. So I kind of got nervous. Well, I'm telling myself, Lauren said, you're robbing those people. So I said to Lauren, I said, you take up the next offering and show me how to do it. And he did. Right here, I'll show you how to take up an offering. You know? And I came to the realization that I was robbing God's people. Because God set up an economy. Not me. I didn't set it up. But God said, give.
Yes.
Then I realized that if you truly want to see people saved and you truly want to do something for God, you're going to give into the ministry. That we can do things. Now what we do, and it's on a small basis, a small level, yeah. But we buy the Bibles. I tell Mom every month, I buy some Bibles when they do the Bible fund because they offer them a little cheaper. And then we get them back there in the back, the Expositor Study Bible. We get them. We get the little New Testaments, and then we get the big ones, we get the Crossfire ones, and we get some of the books. There's a book, a couple of the books that he has out that are real good to get. And then I give them out. Then we don't have it anymore. I'll go back to the shelf. There's nothing left. I've given them all away. I give them away. You know, they're $50, $60. You know, give them away. But I know that we'll be blessed.
Yes.
And we're giving away what? We're giving away the Word of God. That's why I've given several away, you know. And so we continue to do that. And then we continue to give, knowing that we'll be blessed. Because when you give, you always. And it's hard, though, sometimes. I don't know about you, but sometimes you can't get that $20 bill out of your hand. The devil will say, well, what about that electric bill? Remember, you owe Jay Wanamaker for doing that thing in the bed of the truck, you know? Like, uh-oh, well, I'll Jeanette pay that. But you need to give so that you can receive. Hallelujah. Where were we? I got to put my glasses back on. Therefore, we are buried with him by baptism unto death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even though we should also walk in a victorious life, newness of life. Verse 4. That's where our victory comes from, in Christ. And then we receive that power of the Holy Spirit to do those things that we have to do. And the Holy Spirit will clean you up. Mm-hmm. Heard a preacher, when I was a kid one time, some preacher said, well, don't preach for perfection so you don't have to go do anything. And I thought, well, at the time it sounded pretty good. But later on I thought, well, God's not going to have you be imperfect. So even if you pray for it or not, God's still going to perfect you, because the Bible talks about that He's going to work that thing in you. He's going to bring perfection in your life. And He will allow storms to come sometimes. He'll allow trials to come sometimes. Even though the word of faith used to preach, well, you can just speak it all away. No, you can't. There's times you've got to put your faith in God and allow God to take you through whatever it is. To learn something on the other side. Do you truly believe it? Do we truly believe, and I'm preaching to myself, you're listening, Pastor Mark, do you truly believe that God will give me this day my daily bread? That's talking about physical needs and spiritual needs. Do I believe it? Or am I like the Israelites that thought, well, I better go collect a little more just in case God isn't faithful? Hello? Maybe God won't take care of this. And boy, the devil likes to come too, doesn't he?
No.
Sometimes it's just our own flesh. Mm-hmm. For we have been planted together in verse 5 in the likeness of His death. Turn the page. We shall also in the likeness of His resurrection, knowing this, that the old man is crucified with Him. The old man, the old person we were, is crucified with Him, that the body of sin might be destroyed. The body of sin, the human body, what it's saying is sin working in this human body can be destroyed. It's the body that sins. And you sin, spirit, soul, and body, by the way. I had an argument with it. They said, well, my spirit's. But Paul talked about filthiness of the spirit. Uh-oh. And some tried to separate those. I found that, well, we used to have a real nice little definition for the spirit, the soul, the body, but we found that the spirit and the soul are kind of intertwined. And the Bible refers to both, and there's an intertwined. But we're all intertwined. We're one. We're three in one. And so my spirit went along when I did the sin. Hello? Well, thank God we can ask for forgiveness, and God will forgive you. And this is another thing. The devil will try to say, well, you did it too many times. I didn't. There's sin abound, grace is much more abound. You got to get back up like that song says. We fall down, but we get up.
Yeah.
Now, is it Ephesians or Galatians? It talks about which one of you people are spiritual? Which one of you people are mature? I seen people fall, and I seen other people. Well, I'm glad I'm not as bad as you. And if you would just be like me, you would have never have done that. Did you see how bad she was? I don't even think we should have her come to our church anymore. But the Bible talks about restoring that person. But it says those who are mature. To understand that that which affected her could affect me. Understanding that that might not be my problem, but I got my own. Like I remember Lauren Larson said, eat off your own plate. I like that when he said that. Because he talked about getting up and falling. And they said, well, what is your problem, Brother Lauren? And Brother, I'm not going to tell you. Eat off your own plate. In other words, you got enough of your own problems. Don't worry about mine. You know? So I stole that from Brother Lauren. I was listening to Gabriel preach one day. He said something. He said, well, I got this from Dad, and he said, I think Dad got it from Paul or Papal, Jimmy Swaggart. And he said, Jimmy Swaggart probably stole it from somebody else. He said, so I. But it's good, you know.
That's right.
He said that Donnie take those Bibles and mark them up, and then I heard him talking. He says, then Gabe comes in and steals them from him. Because he has them all marked up, and then he, you know, nothing wrong with that. Learning from those that were on before us, amen. Hallelujah. That the old man is crucified, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin. For he who is dead is freed from sin. Now, if we be dead with Christ, and the Greek says, now since we are dead with Christ, hello? We believe that we shall also live with him. We continue to have that faith in him. We have to keep that faith that we will live with him. We died with him. We're buried with him, thank God. Do you understand why? I don't know if I... Linda, you can't get remarried because Jay's alive. Why not? There's a marriage contract. Hello? So she can't legally get remarried unless Jay died. There has to be a death in order for there to be a remarriage. In our case, then, we're made dead to the sin nature. So we have died in that then we can be, and this is how Paul tries to explain it, we can then be remarried, or we can be married to Christ or to the new nature. We can be married to grace. The old has passed away. And so now we can have we are a new creation, and now we have that new spirit. We have the old nature. Now the old nature stays there, but we also have the new nature, the divine nature. And so we aren't committing what they call spiritual adultery, but one is dead. So Paul's saying, well, if you're dead, and the Lord showed me that right here in this church, before I even really started studying all this, I was standing up here, and Dad was laying there in a coffin. He was laying right there. And I looked at him laying there. The Lord said to me, is he doing anything? Because, well, what it was, someone put cookies in there. Those archway cookies. Someone laid the cookies in there. I seen them. The Lord says, is your dad eating those cookies? I said, no. Is he doing anything? If he had any plans or anything, is he doing those? And I said, no. And the Lord says, why not? And I said, because he's dead. And that's the same way we are to the sin nature. We're now dead. But then you can take it a step further, that then you were risen in life and connected to a new power that you can walk in newness of life. You see how the Lord, through progressive revelation, showed that. He told him in the Garden of Eden that the seed of a woman would bruise or crush the seed crush the devil. He didn't say how, you know. Then he goes on, and there's prophecies and stuff. But Abraham and Isaac was a type of Christ. And so he tells Abraham, he says, go sacrifice him. And so Abraham goes up to do it. They said, well, Abraham knew that God would raise him from the dead or something, I guess, you know. Jehovah Jireh, the Lord will provide. He'll provide a Savior. It says, and then the angel, and they stop Abraham from crucifying Isaac. But in the mind of Abraham, Isaac died and was brought back. That's the way that God used to show. And then Jesus went on to say, but Abraham seen my day. Now some don't know. Scholars go, well, how much did Abraham know? Well, we don't know. But I know that Abraham knew. Because he told Isaac that God would supply the lamb. He would supply the sacrifice. And so now we see that Abraham knew that God would supply the lamb. And that's what he did. And that's what we're talking about now. Mary, did you know? And we don't know what all Mary knew. I've read about that. You know, I've read through the account again. She knew that it was going to be the Son of God and so forth. But I don't know how much she knew. I don't know how much God told her. Later on, though, it does talk about her referring to him as her Savior. And so, she must have known that. But then God continually reveals himself. And then you have Paul come along. How can Paul be used? Then Paul was killing the Christians. They think that Paul was there when they stoned Stephen and so forth, you know. And yet, Paul has a revelation. And then Paul goes on, and it says that Paul had problems for a while. Paul was still trying to live for the Lord and trying to do it by law. There's a period of time, you know, we don't see it. In the Bible goes from one chapter to the next. When he really starts thinking about it, 14 years went by. You know, he went, you know. And it took a while, but the Lord showed him the message of the cross. And so he came back and he began to teach him and to show him the message of the cross. But it's all in the cross. It's all in what Christ did. It's all in Christ. And you know, it takes the weight off. Because, you know, I remember school days, you know, way back. You were smart, you know, sending them kids into a hellhole. Dad wouldn't send us either, but he wasn't intelligent enough. Well, not intelligent. He didn't know that you were allowed to homeschool. He thought you had to be. I remember him saying, and I wish to God. And now even people who aren't Christian don't send their kids into it. But much more Christians, you know. And you know, and you may say what you want about them kids of yours. I don't know what you think about them. But when the going got tough, they turned to God. They were on there like, pray for mom. We know that God can do this.
Yeah.
Now sometimes maybe their lives, and we see that. But the Bible says that when you raise them, you know, and you're not perfect. And no parents are perfect. I have to tell you stuff about the Inuit, you know. No parents are perfect. I wasn't perfect, you know. But thank God that He sent His Son to die for us.
Amen.
And He revealed Himself. He's revealing Himself to us. Hallelujah. Knowing that Christ, being raised from the dead, dieth no more. Death has no more dominion over Him. He dies no more. What does that mean? He said on the cross, it is finished.
Yes,
it is. That's right. He don't have to die again.
That's right.
And we don't have to re-crucify Him again, Catholics. Oh, well, you're rough. No, but you know what? I'm going to be honest. And I'm on tape, so I'll probably get in trouble. But there's going to be a lot of Catholics going to wake up in hell and wonder if they can't get out there. Or why they're there. Because they listened to that doctrine and they thought that they were okay. And they're not okay. You must be born again.
Yes. Right.
Your faith
right.
has to be in Him. Not in
man.
Religious things that
yes.
you do.
Rituals
yes. and so forth. And I feel sorry for them because some feel, and I don't want them to go there. They don't have to come here to church. I don't care where they go. But they need to find a church that's a true Bible believing preaching church.
Right.
And you listen to the stuff and you're looking and you're thinking, what? They don't know why. Why do you eat fish on Fridays? We don't know. But it makes us more righteous.
I'd be in trouble.
No, it don't.
No,
it
makes you smell like fish.
And you can eat fish on Friday. I mean, I don't care. I mean, I eat fish all the time.
I don't eat fish at all.
You might, probably should try that.
I'd be starving.
You eat that holy fish. No, what I'm saying is, isn't it neat that you don't have to perform? You just receive
yeah.
and accept that righteousness that's yours.
Yes, Lord.
Because Amen.
Christ said it is finished. He doesn't.
Yes.
No, we have to die no more. And He didn't go into hell. He wasn't punished either. When He went into hell, then He was shook.
Yeah.
That's right.
You see what happened when He was here.
Yes.
The demons, you are the Son of God. Are you here to torment us before our time?
Yeah.
And yet some preach that He went to hell. No. Then that means that Jesus lied to you. Because while He was still on the cross, He gave up, as He died purposely, gave His life, as He gave it, He said, it is finished. He didn't say, it is finished, but I got to go down and be tormented in hell. No, He didn't say that. And when He went down into hell, and we don't know what all was done, but we know He went to captivity. In other words, they were captive of Satan, and He went and loosed them from that and took them out. And guess what happened? Some of them stopped off on earth and walked around. Can you imagine?
Yeah.
Well, Linda, you've been dead for 20 years, and all of a sudden you're on your way to heaven. You stop by to say hi to me on the way. And that's what they said happened.
God can do.
The power of God.
God.
And God's body that's over there is going to come out of that grave too. The spirit and the soul have went to be with the Lord with that body, but it'll be a different body. It'll no longer have blood in it. The life will be in the spirit. It'll be a young body. It'll be able to do things we can't do now.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Scholars say, they're smarter than I am, so they agree. But scholars say that we'll actually be transported by the speed of thought. They said Jesus walked through walls. And yet you could touch him. The glorified body. And know what thrills me? They say the earth will change. Scripture says that the earth is crying out right now, doesn't understand why it's in the condition it's in. Because of sin. But what's this place going to look like when sin's no longer here? It's tainted by sin now. Now, how I think of tainted. Have you ever put on sunglasses that are a different color and it kind of taints things, everything looks a little different? But to take those off and see things, that's what it's going to be like. No sin.
Hallelujah.
No more tempter.
No.
Linda, no more hospitals. No more gray hair. I remember before it was gray. It'll be back to where it was before. Well, I said, I can't really say much anymore. My cousin looked at me. It was been a while back. I was only about 50, and I wasn't getting real gray yet. My cousin Jay, I don't know if you know J.D. Whip. I went up to get something done. And he looked at me and said, somebody, you must not be a true DeWitt or something. I said, why? He said, you're not gray. And he's all gray on the side. He's a few years younger than me. Well, I'm catching him now, you know. Still have it, though. I didn't lose it, thank God. But one day, if you keep your faith there, and we go through these trials and these testings, and we fall at times, and if you fall, don't let the devil keep you down, but get back up. And those that are up, you help them get back up, and you help them to stay up, and you encourage them. You know, I watched MASH on TV, one of my favorite shows. And you know what they did? You know what Hawkeye had the audacity to do? Is when that soldier would come in on that stretcher and he would be bleeding, Hawkeye had the audacity to take care of him and try to get him better. He didn't bury him. And what I've seen, I talked to a preacher one time that messed up. And he told me, he said, Mark, I had nowhere to go. He said the church would have buried me. They wouldn't have helped me.
That's right. It's true. Come on.
But they would have buried me. Are we going to help people? We're going to bury them. Are we going to be that MASH unit and take them to the healer and help them and pray for them and uplift them?
Come on.
Right.
Or are we going to bury them and talk about them? That's another thing I seen. And there were some, these people love the Lord. I'm not saying they weren't saved. I know some of them were truly saved. I feel they were, you know. We really can't. It's hard for us to judge somebody's heart. We can't do. But I felt that they were saved. But boy, some of them were gossips. I remember the prayer chains. Those prayer chains became gossip chains. They didn't really care that Linda was in the hospital or whatever. They were talking about, well, I bet you. You know what they used to say? Well, you must not be living right. You must have some sin in your life because your heart's messing up. What's the sin? Get it out. Kind of like Job's friends.
Yeah.
Maybe just the heart messed up on its own. Mm-hmm. Maybe just things happen. Yeah, maybe it's just what we deal with in this flesh.
That's right.
You know, a long time ago, I had the question. You weren't allowed to tell anybody you were sick. That was not faith. So I'd get sick and I couldn't tell nobody. The Bible used to say, well, go and have them pray for you. Well, how do you go pray for them? As soon as I came and said, hey, Jay, I got this fever. Will you pray for me? Well, I'm speaking negative. So I... And I remember years ago, I was only a young man then. I heard Brother Swigert preach on that, of all things. I can't remember if I sent and got tapes or what, but he says, you know what? The body's going to wear out regardless of how much faith you have or not.
Amen.
And he said, eventually the heart's going to stop, or the kidneys are going to quit, or the liver's going to, because the Bible says it's appointed unto man once to die. so you're still going to die. I don't care how much. They say, hey, you can still die. Sitting at his kitchen table, looked at his wife, and his head went down. And took him to the hospital, and he died. I lived to be in his 80s, you know. I don't even know what to kind of preach to you. You can have all this great health forever, you know. But Brother Swagger said about that, is he knew these faith preachers, he knew them personally. And they were all saying, hey, they're 20 or young. He said, so they started out preaching about health. Health, it's easy for somebody 25 years old to preach about health. They're healthy, man. But he said, what happened? They started getting older. So they switched from health to prosperity because, and then they were getting facelifts and getting all kinds of stuff done to look like they weren't aging anymore. Isn't that stupid? I'm aging. I'm going to age. My hair, that's it. Sin. That's the effects of sin in this world. We can't, you know. Abraham died. You know? So don't allow them to someone to say, well, that person has sin, or you have sin. Sometimes things just happen. We should be there just to pray for people. Mm-hmm. Yes. I'm not saying there's not sin, but you know what? Even if there is, then what you need to do is pray for them. You know, having daddy as a preacher, I've seen all kind of stuff. And I remember people that would bring the lists in. Every Monday morning, there was a guy. And Dad was trying to be nice, and Dad was young at it. And so this guy would bring the list in of everything he preached wrong. Now, the guy that did it had a problem with pride. Even though he tried to say he didn't, but that's pride for you. You're going to set the pastor straight, you know. Finally, Dad got to the place, he said, keep your list, you know. But that was bringing attention to himself. Oh, I'm this great, I'm going to set somebody straight. But there's no notoriety, there's no fame in saying, well, yeah, maybe what the pastor preached wasn't quite right. I'm going to get on my knees in my prayer closet, as Jesus said, and no one will see me. But when you preach, Linda, you preach, right? You ever preach to people that kind of suck it out of you? You look at them like somebody's in me. You ever notice when I start preaching, you notice I'll kind of focus on certain ones and I kind of stay away from other ones? You probably don't notice that.
Not yet.
You'll feel it.
Yeah.
And you'll look at them, and when you connect with them, it starts to pull that. They're hungry and they start to pull it out of you. And you know that they're praying for you. And but then I've gotten those that. And you can feel it. It's like you're preaching and bam, your words just fly right back at you. And I've had them sit in the front a couple of times. And so I learned that from Dad. Dad said, don't look at their faces. But I found that certain people, now there's no one really in here that I have to, that's doing this, stopping it today. But you'll have that. You know? And so you focus on those that you get someone that's not agreeing with you, and oh my goodness, you know. You can feel it in the realm of the Spirit. Let's all stand. Father, we thank you. Say you can come up with me. I don't know if Mom can, you know. Can you put this something on back there, like the altar stuff that we have? Or,
yeah.
And I never give them enough notice. So I keep saying, I'm going to change and give them more notice, you know. And I never do. And but oh well. You can pray for me that I do that. You ever watch, when I watch the telecast, they'll always, when they're getting ready to get done, they'll say, okay, the praise team, come back up here while we're getting ready, you know. But I've had heard them say, I've heard Donna, one time I heard Jimmy say, I'm going to be all the way through the song before you can finally get playing it on. If anybody needs prayer, we'll pray with you. I don't care what the thing are. Bob, can you come up here? Are you able to? I want you to pray with us. Bob was used mightily in healing. Jeanette had been prophesied over to be used in healing. And so you want to use those gifts. Huh? What do you need prayer? Okay. Jeanette? Bob, you pray. Father, I thank you now. We just ask that you bring her direction, Father. Reveal yourself to her in the mighty name of Jesus. Oh, bring peace, Father. Bring contentment, Lord God. Oh, Father. Father, yes, reveal who you are. We thank you. Direct you in every aspect of our life. And we thank you and praise you now in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Yes, Lord.
Anybody else need prayer for anything?
Send these people out. I know we've got another week. We've got another week that we can go out and we can share salvation with others. That's what we're. That's what we come in here to get filled up so that we can go out. That's our job.
Yes, Lord.
That's our job as Christians. That's our responsibility.
Yes.
That's our privilege to go out and share what we've seen and heard in here with others and bring them into a place
so that
they can grow in the Lord. And we thank you for that freedom, Lord,
thank
we have in our country. We lift up our president, Lord Jesus.
Yes,
we lift
Lord.
Up our country.
Yes.
We say thank you, Lord,
yes,
for a
Jesus.
Country such as ours.
Yes,
in Jesus'
Lord.
Name. And as we as Christians can take that
Lord.
Responsibility
you,
and go out there, let's change our world. Let's
thank
not just
Lord.
Talk about it. Let's change it. And we can. because we have the power and the authority from Jesus Christ and His Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.